Thank you, Brother Demas, Brother Carl Shakarin, or Demas Shakarin, Brother Carl Williams, and delegates all. I just think that Brother the Plowman here just expressed what I wanted to tonight. That he just taken my speech right from me. Because I have enjoyed this, I believe this convention more than any convention I've ever been in. I've never seen in any convention more harmony and such real fellowship and brotherly love. Another thing that I've done, I've met many new delegates of heaven, new brethren, and I've had the privilege to shake hands with and talk to. Just a few nights ago, I was listening to the Baptist brother sitting over here. I can't think of his name.
Irvin.
And he brought a card to me from, I believe it's his aunt, that's sitting here tonight. She's held that prayer card for some 20 years. She's brought into the meeting dying with a disease that maybe the doctor could explain what it is. It's something like leprosy, but it isn't leprosy. You just, there's an operation that could cut some kind of a card up here or something, but she'd be like a plant. She'd have to sit there. And while she was sitting there, perhaps her card not called or nothing, didn't get in the prayer line, the Holy Spirit directed me to her, and she's back there tonight. Well, we're very thankful for that.
I think Howard Irvin's over speaking to you, but I think the aunt is here. Maybe we can have her stand up.
Would you stand up for the aunt?
There she is. Wave your hand. Wave your hand.
God bless you, my sister, for your gallant faith in the Son of God. May He keep you well until the time He calls you home and this mortal will take on immortality. I'm so thankful for that, and to think she held that card for all these years now, and then was brought here to me and showed me tonight. You know, I was saying, it's like bread up on the water, it returns to you. While you try to do something for somebody else. Now, I have also had the privilege of meeting many of these fine ministers, and I certainly appreciate their fine fellowship, this cooperation. Brother Carl announced me to be back next year. If the Lord is willing, and we are here on earth, and I hope to meet every one of you here next year again.
Right.
And each one bringing another delegate with him, and with sheep. Now, there's just one thing that I would like to say a little something about, maybe for just a moment, because Dr. Reed is to speak next, and I've come all the way up here tonight. I've got 250 miles and I had to make this trip to hear Dr. Reed, and just something happened a while ago that I would, but Dr. Reed, I'd drive 1,000 miles to hear him. But something is, since I've been here, I would drive 1,000 miles just to hear what I heard a little while ago. Such a wonderful thing. Something that flesh and blood cannot reveal. It takes the Holy Spirit to do it. And to see someone who encouraged my life in such a way, and I certainly would be very grateful all the rest of my life. What I wanted to say was, if I ever have to have an operation, call on a medical doctor, you come to me, Dr. Reed, right away. I can trust a man to operate if I have to have one. Hands that believes in God, that would be the one I'd want working on me.
Glory to God. And
so I trust I'll never have to have it, but if I do, I'd want a man like him to do the work if he couldn't be there. I had something that happened last night, yesterday afternoon, that was really kind of strange to me. And I'll be brief because I don't want to take my brother's time as he's going to speak. But I suppose it's kind of a complimentary to my ministry. I watch little things, just every little thing has a meaning to me. I don't believe that anything happens to a Christian by chance. I think it's ordained of God. Because Jesus said He'd make all things work together for good to them that loved Him. So therefore, I believe that every little thing in the little humble ministry that He has given me to help you people, to help everyone, and you all are help to me, helping each other to get to glory. In that, every little thing has a meaning to me. But it was hard for me to believe that yesterday afternoon when I lost my text up here. I tell you, I never was so gotten in my life. And then my wife gave me a new Bible for Christmas. My old one was just worn out. I've had it almost 20 years now. It was given to me by the Houston Gospel Tabernacle people many years ago when I started out on the campaigns. And So I cherish it so much, and I've the leaves and pages of crossing the sea and around until it's just dropping out. I pick up a page maybe in Genesis, have to look back over Deuteronomy somewhere to find it, you know, where they stuck it back in the Bible. So she got me one for Christmas, and I hate to lay the old book aside. It's been so dear to me. I said, if I went before Jesus comes, lay it on me. Let it just go down with me, and I'll come up with it when we come. So then, that's my opinion. Anyhow, as I used to tell a little story, I hope this is not sacrilegious, but I went to a man told me one time, it'll be his brother Earl Prickett, meeting up in New York. And I met a man, he said, say, what do you do with these businessmen being a preacher? I said, I'm a businessman. And he said, what kind of business you're in? I said, assurance. Now he thought I said insurance, you see. So I said, assurance. He said, oh, what kind of assurance do you sell? I said, eternal life. I said, I don't want to sell it. I'm just a policy holder myself, and I try to prescribe it to others. Remember a boy I went to school with one time, he was an insurance salesman. Now insurance is all right, but I don't have any. So he come to my house and he said, Billy, I'd like to sell you some insurance that I know your brother, my brother sells for Metropolitan. He said, well, I said, I'd like to sell you some insurance. I said, oh, Wilmer, thank you. And he may be here tonight, his brother. He writes the articles in the upper room, this book, the upper room. So I said, I have assurance. He said, what? And my wife looked at me as if I was a hypocrite. She said, Billy? And I said, yes. I said, I have assurance. And he said, oh, I'm sorry. He said, I heard that you didn't have any insurance. And I said, no, I have assurance. And he caught me when I said that. He said, what did you say? I said, assurance. And he said, well, what do you mean? I said, blessed assurance. Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. I'm an heir of salvation, purchase of God, born of His Spirit, washed in His blood. He said, Billy, you know I appreciate that. So that's a very good thing. But said, son, that'll not put you out here in the graveyard. I said, but get me out. I'm not worried about I'm not bothered about getting in, it's getting out. You know? So I think that's the way we feel about it. Last evening, when I picked up that Bible and I couldn't find that text, and I picked up that new Bible, and I was reading out the old, and I picked up the new one and put it under my arm and run up here, and I turned over to that place, and I thought, well, here, I believe it was St. John 16:21, and it wasn't the reading at all. I said to Brother Moore, is that where that's at? Yes. And I looked back, and it wasn't there. So I thought, well, I got a mispaced page in. Then my brother here, Brother Stanley, he came over, Bishop Stanley, rather, and I don't know what the man meant. It was such a comfort. He walked up close to my side and he said, hold steady, brother. God is maybe going to do something. And that just encouraged me to think that he had said that. I wonder if he realized he prophesied. But talking to him a few moments ago, just before getting up here, I'm sure he did. So I brought in my message upon the birth pains and so forth, and my little rude way of doing it about the lily, how it's born down and begotten and comes up and draws up the sun, the dewdrop, and so forth. And then the corruption of what it has to die out of, to be born out of, rather, to come out. And I was trying to make an illustration of the church. Just like the doctor here. If he went to treat a patient, we've got doctors today that says you can rub your foot on the back of the heel and heal a cancer on your face, you see. But a good doctor wouldn't listen to such a thing as that. He treats the patient according to the book that he's reading on medical research. And that's what I try to do to treat the patient. When I see the church sick, I don't want to try to tell them they need a new handshake or something like that, a new organization. I have to treat it according to the book that I know it's in. And so when I see the church look like breaking out with measles, I want to take the very prescription I think is right, and for the measles to get it out of the church. And I see sin breaking out in it the same way. I try to make a comparison with Esau and Jacob, and then bringing times down, and I won't go into that, but bring it down to the last part, and my last scripture to use was comparing it, not unscripturally, but as Jesus said it would be, what the main doctor said the condition of the church should be in this last days. It would be a Laodicea, rich, blind, naked, poor church, and it would be compared with the days of Sodom. Now, we know that's the truth. If you notice it historically, he brought in the days of Noah first, and then the days of Sodom. And that's just the way it's traveled, just the same way. And history has many times repeats itself. History does, and so does promises of the Bible. For instance, like in Matthew 3, where it said, out of Egypt I've called my son. Now, if you run the reference on that, it was Jacob, his son, he called out of Egypt. That was his lesser son, but his great son, Jesus, was called out of Egypt too. So it had a compound answer. So, and seeing as they went along talking about that, and then I brought my thoughts of that, and I walked out of off the platform and went out. My children going home wanted to stop out here somewhere to get a sandwich. And I went in, the wife said, Billy, I was so nervous, I didn't know what to do. I said, I gave you that Bible. I said, you never wrote it, and you never put it together, honey. She said, but just to think, I gave you a Bible that had a flaw in it. I said, well, maybe it wasn't. And so one of the children picked it up, and we filled the pages. No, it looked all right, but right down at the bottom, it was two pages sticking together, see? And the 16th chapter was on this side, and then the continuation of the 16th chapter come up on the other side, and the 17th started on the, see, just perfectly exactly the same across, and that Indian paper, real thin, sticking together, and I was reading now the 17th chapter all the time instead of the 16th chapter. Well, I thought, God, why did you do that? Why would there be such a thing? Now, that's me feeling in order to see what it was all about, because I think nothing happens by chance. And I was thinking about the comfort of this brother here coming, tell me, hold steady. Him being a priest, hold steady. Maybe God is going to do something, or something in that manner. And I thought, how could that be? And then sitting there like a thunderbolt out of heaven, it came to me. This might not make sense to you, but it does to me. See, I remember in Luke, the 4th chapter, that Jesus entered the synagogue at Nazareth, where he was brought up at, as his custom was to go into the church, the synagogue on the Sabbath. And when he did, we notice there that the priest gave him the Bible, the scroll. Jesus, looking through the scroll, found a certain place, Isaiah 61, and he read the scripture. Then he handed the Bible back to the minister, and then as he turned to the audience, all eyes was up on him. And he said, this day, this scripture is fulfilled. And we know how peculiar that scripture reading was, because he just took a portion of the first and second verses of Isaiah 61, 1 and 2. But he read down this far, where the Spirit of the Lord is upon me, to bind up the brokenhearted, and to give, heal the sick, and to open the blinded eyes, and to preach the acceptable year of the Lord. And then he stopped, for the next was to bring judgment. That would apply to his second coming, not his first coming, and he stopped and turned around and said, this day, this scripture is fulfilled. How direct that was, and what a statement it was to the teachers and to the people that were present, that he could make this plain to the people, this day, this scripture is fulfilled. For here he was, the Messiah, yet they didn't believe it. Here he was, the anointed one for that hour. Every bit of his ministry from his birth up had proved to be what he was. And yet they could not believe it. What a statement. But he could say today, and if a person opened up their eyes, they could have known what day that they were living in, for that was his hour. For he was right there doing exactly what the scriptures, all the prophets had said had happened in that day. Here he was doing exactly what God had prophesied would happen. How did they miss seeing it? They should have known right quick, seeing what his ministry was, there's the Messiah. They would have known it, because he said the scripture is fulfilled. I think of today, and notice what that was. As the priest gave the word over, the word was read and handed back to the priest, and the last quotation out of my text that I had, and my scriptures wrote down, was St. Luke 17:30. Where Jesus, referring back to this day that we're living in, rich Laodicea age, and yet rotten in politics, church politics, and national politics, just as rotten as it could be. And then he said, as it was in the days of Lot, so shall it be in the coming in time. Notice what he said there. In the day that the Son of Man will be revealed. In the days that the Son of Man will be revealed. I want to draw your attention. See, he came in three names. He came as Son of Man, which was prophet. And that's what he did. He proved his ministry by being a prophet. We all know that. Every one of us knows it. He never said he was the Son of God. He said he was the Son of Man. Now today he is the Son of God, which he returned back, and now he's in the form of the Holy Ghost, the unseen person, but yet God, the Son of God. In the millennium, he sets upon his Father's throne, which he'll be Son of David. He revealed himself first as Son of Man, a prophet. This age, to the church age, Son of Man, or Son of God. And in the other age, Son of David. Three sons. But you notice here, he said, at the ending of the church age, it had gotten such a mess, till he would be revealed again as Son of Man. When the Son of Man is being revealed. How appropriate was that mix-up yesterday, and I hope you don't miss it. We have had the revelation of Son of God. But the last promise that Abraham had before the Son was made or brought into existence, the one that he was been promised before the promised Son showed up, God manifested himself there at Sodom as a prophet, being a man in flesh. God Elohim, as I heard someone speaking a while ago, which the Godhead bodily was in him. He was the fullness. Elohim is the fullness of the Godhead bodily. And we notice there, when Abraham saw him coming, he said, "My Lord," there were three of them. And down in Sodom, Lot saw two and said, "My Lord's." Amen. Lack of revelation. So notice what taken place here. When he come up high, he made himself known. Could I not say this if I'd just been on my toes? See? The brother prophesied when he said to me what he did. This day, watch what he did right after the reading of that scripture. In the days when the Son of Man, not a man, not a human being, the Son of Man will reveal himself among his people. Again, this day, this promise of this hour that we're now living in is fulfilled before our very eyes. He turned immediately to the congregation and 10 or 12, whatever people it was out there, unknowing. He did the very same thing he did at Sodom. Amen. This day, has this scripture been made manifest before you? It's been made true before you. Then, my brother, sister, delegates, ministers, whatever we are here, children of God, how close are we to His coming then? If we're now seeing the scripture that He promised just before the fire fell in Sodom to burn it up and liken this day to it, and seeing that scripture right before our eyes being fulfilled, how close are we to the coming of the Son of God then? How close is the manifestation of the scriptures like he did through Abraham, bringing the church up in type, which he was the promise to the church. And now we find out Abraham's natural seed, how they failed, but the royal seed of Abraham, which is by faith in the promised word, is now being manifested on the earth today. We are at the end time, my brothers, sisters.
Right.
We're at the end.
Right there.
And we have not one other type. I have to type scriptures because I don't have an education enough to bring out words and things. I make a type, but if I see in the shadows, if I never had seen my hand and see the shadow, I knew I had five fingers. And that's why you have to watch the scripture types of the Old Testament What does it do? It foreshadows this. And Jesus said that Sodom was a foreshadow of the end time now. And the very scriptures that was promised to Sodom, the very scriptures that were taking place in Sodom that Jesus said would repeat itself again in this day, it's made known right before us today. God bless you. Don't miss it. And if I don't see you here next year, when you climb the golden stairs, I hope to meet you up there. God bless you.
Hands upon each one of us here, Lord. Protect all of us. Thou art coming soon. And may we be bold and witness as never before. He's coming soon. Hallelujah. Lord, pour out thy spirit. Send the Holy Ghost and fire. Brand in our hearts, Lord. Impress upon us, Lord, this very thought of thy soon coming. It may be more. It may be night or we know. Would you lift your hands, everyone, lift both hands, worship the Lord. Let him saturate you with his mighty power.
with his spirit and reveal to you exactly where we are in your heart. Oh,
Father, we are, according to the scriptures, we're seeing manifested before us the last sign and type. The words of Jesus Christ said this is so, just as it was at Sodom. We see the world in its condition. We see the church in its condition. We see the elect being called out of every denomination. The life that's in those places moving out now to take the form of the seed. We pray, Heavenly Father, that we awaken it quickly. As a brother just said now, he's seen before his face. And when he had his eyes closed, just masses going before him. Oh God, we feel that there's masses untouched yet. Help us, dear God. May we go from this convention with such a warning in our heart, knowing that this day the scripture is fulfilled. In Jesus' name, amen.
Hallelujah. Our editor, Jerry Jensen, would you come up here? His mother-in-law is unconscious right now. He just got news. And they're ministers of the gospel, Foursquare Ministries. Would we just, I know he's very heavy-hearted. And,
yes, just got
and, and just
heard just now.
Oh,
yeah.
Just
heard. Are they here?
No, they're in Los Angeles. In the coma.
Distance is no difference to God. He's omnipresent. He has to be God. Some of the greatest things that I've known of being done in my own humble ministry is by telephone or someone calling in. Great things taking place. Let us agree together that God will heal this people that's sick. Dear Heavenly Father, we bring them into your presence by prayer. We know that one night it was an apostle that was shut off from all activity then. He was in a jail. And he was going to be beheaded the next day. Down at John Mark's house, they had a prayer meeting. And right in those inner cells, there came that same pillar of fire that followed the children of Israel, or the children of Israel followed it through the wilderness. Came right in because of that prayer meeting and opened every door. And brought the apostle out on the street again, free to minister. We understand that these ministers, missionary people, is bound in now. They're even in a coma. Lord, you are the same yesterday, today, and forever. Hear our prayer tonight, O God. You said when you pray, believe that you receive what you ask for. It shall be given. Lord, we believe. And pray that in Jesus' name that you'll heal them, Lord, for your glory. It's been said, been asked, now let it be done. Amen.
God bless you. You believe with him. Amen.
Thank you, Brother Branham. Praise God. I'd just quickly like to have the men stand up. Brother Argenbright, the International Directors. Stand up, Brother Miner. Jack Moore, stand up. Clifford Ford, Thorfinn from Seattle, Charles Colonel Young, Annie Christopherson, Turlock, Jasper Engler, Ike Aguinini from Hawaii, and I was not how he blessed our souls here the other day. Love it. Our U.S. Ambassador, who served under seven presidents, Bill Rowe, William Rowe, God bless Rowe. Dr. Reed, one of our directors, too, God bless Reed. Earl Brickett. And Brother Branham was given an honorary membership, life membership, fully under his name. In one of the few that was voted on by the Board of Directors many years ago. And Carl Williams, we love him so much. And Henry Krause, the plow manufacturer. Jewel Rose, our Secretary of Treasury. Farmer, Frank Boyle, international director, and I can't, Frank, would you, I can't.
Derek.
Oh, Brother Derek Prince, how we appreciate his ministry, my, and so wonderful, and so much. Dr. Stanley, from the Catholic, Eastern Catholic, Brother Howard Irvin, so you're back there,
Howard Irvin, and we just had your...
Was it Aunt?
We just had her stand a moment ago, Howard, while you were with the young people. And I'd like to see that picture, Brother Branham's, 20 years ago. Brother Norwood from Kansas City, Brother Ben Smart from Colorado, Herbert Bonham from Los Angeles, he's one of the directors of Los Angeles chapter, doing the great work there, and Ted Weiss from Pasadena sitting over there. Art Wilson here, we didn't have a place enough here for him, so he said they're all ladies. And all the ladies here are directors' wives and all the wonderful people. Did I miss anyone else? Some of the other directors had to go home yesterday. Daryl Hahn and several others had to leave. So let's see all these men. We appreciate all their efforts. And anybody? Brother Brandon, come here, Brother Brandon. You recognize that song?
No, sir. A lot of change since those days, Brother.
Very hard. He's a very handsome fellow, and he's still handsome, Brother Random. And that's a nice picture.
Yes.
And we had your aunt to stand a moment ago, too. And maybe you'd like to say a word, Howard?
Between 12 and 15 years ago, Aunt Edith was healed of Raynaud's disease, which I understand is medically incurable. I don't know whether Brother Branham told you the circumstances, and I wonder if I might take just one moment to do so. This is her card that she got for the healing line. She never got in the healing line. She was seated in the second row in the auditorium here in Phoenix. Brother Branham had preached his heart out, was just too exhausted to pray for people, but suddenly looked down at her, looked directly at her, and said, "You can be healed if you want to be." And she went out of that meeting healed and is still healed. Yes, I understand that the disease was incurable, and our physicians here will check me. I'm a layman at medicine, but I understand that it's a disease of the nerves that affects one similar to leprosy. The nerves choke off the blood supply, and eventually the fingers just rot and fall off. There was one medical operation that the surgeon in the East told them they could perform, and that was to cut a nerve up in here, but if they had, she'd have been a vegetable. But God, by His mighty power, has healed her, and she's healed today.
Let's just have her stand up again back there.
Would you stand up, Annie?
There it is. 20 years later.
About 15 years.
15 years later.
15 years. Thank the Lord. There's one man they left out. We all appreciate Brother Shikari. No, we ever want to...
Out of the wall once and watching the people come by and put into the treasury of God. And you've seen this widow come by with just a small amount of money, just a few pennies of tithing, and perhaps had some children at home, but she was interested in the kingdom. There's no doubt that that has been recopied again tonight. There's been many people that's put in practically all we've got right here in this offering, because it has been so placed before us that there is a need and our hearts are in this, Father. I've often thought perhaps if I'd have been standing there, it'd been me looking at that widow, I'd have run to her and said, "Don't do it, sister. We don't need it." But maybe it would have been wrong. You never told her not to do it. You just didn't watch her do it. Yeah. Or you know from her heart, you'd repay her for that. Father, I know that you know the intents of every heart that placed in here tonight. And what it's for the kingdom's sake, Lord, that the this work that we're so wonderfully enjoying, this fellowship, Lord, of all of the great denominations of the world. We have feel that we're such a privileged people to be here tonight in the presence of God, feeling this great word coming forth and making manifest, proving God being in our midst. God, give to each and every one here as they have need. We pray now that you'll bless the offering for its intended use. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.